On this Sabbath day, I wanted to offer a simple word of encouragement as you watch our virtual worship. I'm grateful for all the volunteers who are working with David Goins, our Director of Music and Worship, to make all of this happen. First United Methodist Church is certainly blessed with awesome talent. First Church is using many forms of social media to stay connected, and the church's purpose has not changed as we glorify God by connecting people through to Jesus Christ through spiritual nourishment and dynamic outreach. Several of the church's small groups have already begun regular meetings through social media platforms, and I want to congratulate you on taking that initiative. I also want to remind you that at present, all in-person activities and events at the church have been canceled through April 11th. But don't be surprised if we have to extend those cancellations. The well-being of everyone is our number one priority. Today's emphasis is on the Good Shepherd, and I hope you will find it a comfort, peace, and endurance, knowing that Christ has not abandoned us in these days. Now, more than ever, it's important for you to make contact with your friends, your neighbors, and your church family. Go ahead, pick up the phone and give them a call. Take a moment to offer a prayer with them. Simply pray a prayer of thanksgiving for the one you're talking to and ask God to continue to be with them. This is not complicated, but it is an opportunity to draw on the strength of the Good Shepherd who provides and protects us all. And now enjoy today's worship.
Hello, everyone. I am Debbie Eisen, your liturgist this morning for First United Methodist Church. I'm joined by phone by our son Mark and his wife Lindsay and their daughter Evelyn. We like to call her Evie. This morning, as we all attempt to stay healthy in our homes, please join us in the worship of our Lord. Please follow along with the responsive reading followed by a prayer. Coming from places that have seen better days,
God bids us to celebrate this day, a day full of new possibilities.
Coming with our breath taken away by grief,
the Holy Spirit breathes new life within us, renewing our connection with God and with one another.
Coming to worship seeking a hope that will endure,
Christ unbinds the fetters that hold us in death, speaking in word and sacrament, and building community for holy service.
And now we'll have our prayer. It comes from Psalm 130 and John 11. God of life, present and promised, you are the one to whom we call, for you are the one who hears, and you are the one who acts, bringing us new life, with your grace and love and power. Lead us in our time of worship, that maybe we may be prepared to follow your lead in places where life is at risk, places where hope seems far away, places where dreams die during sleep. Help us live the teachings we proclaim through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone at First Church. We are Chris and Emily Powell, and we're just enjoying this beautiful Thursday afternoon in God's creation and thought that we would let you enjoy it too as we worship. You're definitely going to recognize this tune, so we encourage you to sing along from wherever you are.
I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. I will worship, with all of my heart. I will praise you, with all of my strength.
Hey guys, we're meeting in a different place today. This is my living room. So today, Dr. Phil's going to talk about something called the Good Shepherd. So Stella, where's my dog? That's Stella. Sometimes my husband calls her Ginger. But anyway, Stella and I are spending lots of time together here at home, and I'm sure your pets are spending lots of time with you, and they probably are very happy about that. So when we think about the Good Shepherd, we think about shepherds are mentioned many times in the Bible. They had important jobs, and there are shepherds today that have important jobs. What do shepherds need to do? Shepherds need to do a lot of the same kind of things as we need to do with our pets. We need to feed them. We need to water them. We need to let them go outside. We need to do all kinds of things for them because they can't do it for themselves. So shepherds, back in Jesus' time and today, they have to do lots of work because even sheep are not very smart. So they don't know where the food is. They don't know where the water is. And the shepherd has to show them. Well, Dr. Phil's going to talk about the good shepherd. Jesus called himself the good shepherd. Now, what does that mean? Well, we think about all the things that the shepherd has to do. The shepherd has to take care of the sheep. The shepherd has to make sure that the sheep are safe. The shepherd has to give love, loving care to the sheep. Well, Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. Just like the way we take care of our pets is the way that God takes care of us. God wants to make sure that we are okay. God wants to make sure, especially right now when we're stuck inside, God wants to make sure that we feel okay. And ways we can do that are to talk to God as we pray, talk to each other about God, read Bible stories. There are lots of ways that we can connect to God during this time. But it says, Jesus said, the sheep know my voice. Just like Stella knows my voice, God knows your voice, and God cares about your voice. So I think that's the good news for this week. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for the good shepherd Jesus. We thank you for ways that we can take care of our pets and take care of each other. Help us know that you always hear our voice and you always know who we are. Help us listen to your voice and help us follow what you want us to do today and always. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm Julie Hager-Love. I'm the president and CEO of the Kentucky United Methodist Children's Home. It is great to be with you virtually on our first fifth Sunday of the year. We just wanted to come and say, please remember us. Even if you're not worshiping, which we know our churches aren't doing today, please remember our ministry in your giving. You are invited to mail a check to your church or mail it to us or go to our website at kyumh.org and learn about how to give electronically. I've served as president CEO since July, and I want to share one of the scriptures that has been a guiding scripture in my ministry. It's from the Gospel of Matthew, and I'm reading from chapter 18, verses 1 through 5 and 10 through 14. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And he called a little child over to sit among the disciples and said, "I assure you that if you don't turn your lives around and become like this little child, you will definitely not enter the kingdom of heaven. Those who humble themselves like this little child will be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, and whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me." Be careful that you don't look down on one of those little ones. I say to you that their angels in heaven are always looking into the face of my Father who is in heaven. What do you think? If someone has 100 sheep and one of them wandered off, wouldn't he leave the 99 on the hillside and go in the search of the one that wandered off? If he finds it, I assure you that he is happier about having that one sheep than about the 99 who didn't wander off. It is the same way. In the same way, my Father who is in heaven doesn't want to lose one of these little ones. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Our mission is to serve Christ by providing for the physical, emotional, educational, and spiritual needs of children and families. We were founded in 1871 because Methodists after the Civil War saw vulnerable and orphaned children and knew they needed care. Through those 149 years, we've made it through several world wars and even other pandemics. So we know that we will come out on the other side of this stronger. Thank you for your continued support of us. We are still needed in our Commonwealth. In 2019, we served 954 families through all of our ministries of residential care, independent living for young adults, our community-based services, and our work with the Department of Juvenile Justice. Have you ever read a scripture passage you've read it your whole life, and then something happens that just helps you understand it in new ways? One of the ways I've said it is, God hits you with a 2x4 and you go, oh, now I get it. That happened to me early in my ministry here. I was in our office in our Nicholasville campus, and I was looking over the budget. While the state gives us money to help care for children, they never give us even close to enough. And I was working on that, and I was getting a little depressed, I have to be honest, and I just had to take a break. So I walked over to our dining hall, and our staff, our direct care staff, were having a meeting. And they were talking about all the kids in their care. And I knew that the night before, one of our young ladies had not had a great night. So here's what I saw. I saw the staff all talking about this one young lady. One of them said, you know, she really does well when she can journal. So if she's having a rough time, get her to get her journal out and have her write. Another said, I've noticed that at night is when it's hardest for her. So we need to give her a little bit of extra care at night. And it just went on and on around the circle, and they all shared about this one child. And all I could think, all I could feel was God saying, here's what I meant in the scripture when Jesus said, go after the one, leave the 99 and care for the one. Our staff was living out the gospel. They were caring for this one young lady who many in the world have said wasn't important and didn't need to be cared for. But because of you, because of your generosity, we were able to live the gospel and share love with this one young lady. I also want to share a story about work pants. What do I mean by that? Recently, a young man who had aged out of our independent living. Our independent living is for 18 to 21-year-olds who can't be in foster care anymore and still need some help on navigating the world. We provide housing, we help with budgeting, help with finding a job. And he had been with us that whole time when he was 18 to 21. And he'd left the program, but it was still home for him. So when he got a new job, one of the things he had to have was a new uniform, new work pants. And you know what? He knew where to come. He didn't have a family to go to, so he went to the family he knew. He went to our independent living program, to your independent living program, and said, can you help me? And of course we did. They got him the pants, and they celebrated that job with him. Thanks for caring for this one young adult who the world said wasn't important. Our community-based services in Lexington and Owensboro provide counseling and other services to try to help families stay together and to be healthier. In those ministries, we serve several grandparents who are raising grandchildren. And one story I love is of a grandmother raising her teenage grandson. So our staff was able to help them with how to communicate a little bit better with each other, how to understand each other more. And in the midst of this, our staff found out that the young man really wanted to play football. So I don't know if you've ever funded recently even a young person who wanted to participate in sports or other activities in school. It's really expensive. The grandmother didn't have that money, but we knew our generous donors would provide it. So we were able to get him cleats and get him other things he needed, including a bus pass, so he could get to and from practice. You made a difference in this one family. Thank you for caring for the one. Do you remember the young lady I told you about earlier who had had the hard night and staff was discussing how to help her? She left our care earlier this year. Our youth are usually in our residential care around 9 to 12 months, and it was her time to go. But before she left, I saw her and she came up to me and she said, Miss Julie, did you hear that I'm going to be leaving soon? And I said, I did hear. And I want you to remember that you are loved, that I pray for you, and that you will be missed. And she looked at me and she said, I know that I'm loved, and I know that there are people praying for me. And you got to understand, that's really incredible, because when she came to us, she wanted nothing to do with God. And then she looked at me and she said, and you know what? I think I will be missed around here, because I'm kind of a favorite. Isn't that what we want for all the children in our life? To know that they are a favorite, that they are God's child, that they are a person of worth, and they are a favorite. Thank you for providing support for this young lady so she would know what it was like to be a favorite. Thank you for caring for the one. For almost 150 years, Methodists have been serving Christ by providing for the physical, emotional, educational, and spiritual needs of children and families. Thank you for supporting this ministry through your Fifth Sunday giving and other ways. We invite you to send your check to your church or send it to us directly, or to go to our website, kyumh.org, and find ways to give electronically. We can't do it without you. Thank you for helping us care for the one that Jesus said is so important.
There is one thing I desire, one thing I see. To hide in you, abide in you, I'm yours for you to keep. You prepare a table for me, you're my portion and my cup. You are the source of strength. Lord, you have filled me up. You are my shepherd in the wilderness, whom shall I fear? You are the God who goes before me, my rock and my shield. In troubled times you will provide, and I shall not want. You are my God. Though I walk through the valley of death, I will magnify and glorify you with every breath. When the wicked stands against me, I will follow as you lead. You are the truth and way, the lamp unto my feet. You are my shepherd in wilderness, whom shall I fear? You are the God who goes before me, my rock and my shield. In troubled times you will provide, and I shall not want. You are my God. So I'll feel courage, for you have overcome. You will not forsake me, so I wait upon you, Lord. So I'll feel courage, for you have overcome. You will not forsake me, so I wait upon you, Lord. You are my shepherd in the wilderness, whom shall I fear? You are the God who goes before me, my rock and my shield. In troubled times you will provide, and I shall not want. You are my God. You are my God.
Our scripture lesson for today tells us that there was a beautiful relationship between Christ and his people. Jesus said that I am the good shepherd. And it's important to know that from Jesus' day, there were shepherds who were not so good. Some were unfortunate, or may I say, bad. And their sheep would struggle and suffer and waste away. And then there were good shepherds whose sheep would flourish and thrive contently. You know, one of the things that we have in common, I think, is that all of us want to be told by others that we're good at something. You know, like you're a good driver, or you're a good student, or you're a good business person, or you're a good teacher, or whatever the case may be. It means that we know that we are what we're doing and that we're dedicated to doing it well. The good shepherd was one who managed his flock well. And did that by knowing his sheep. And Jesus applied that idea when he said, I know my own, and my own know me. As the Father knows me, and I know the Father. Now you might ask yourself, well, who are the sheep? And the answer is, we are. When I was a kid, we kids would sometimes insult one another with barnyard terms like, you're a pig. Or, you're just a big chicken. But as I thought about it, I don't remember anyone ever insulting me by saying, you're a sheep. And yet in the Bible, you and I are referred to as sheep at least in a half a dozen different books. David said in the 23rd Psalm, the Lord is my shepherd. And that isn't just some kind of religious talk, but rather a language that depicts a special kind of working relationship between us and God. Now the thing is, God knows us. And God not only knows the facts about our life, but God knows us. Right here, right now, right where you're watching this video, God knows you. We are under the care of one who completely and thoroughly understands us through and through. And that is an amazing aspect of God's intimate relationship with us. I can remember as a teenager thinking, why doesn't anybody understand me? But little did I know that the supreme caretaker of my life understood me better than I understood myself. And Jesus doesn't stop there, because as a good shepherd, he sacrifices for his sheep. It says in verse 15, and I lay down my life for the sheep. You see, Jesus' central purpose was for the salvation and the health of the sheep. The cross at Calvary, it graphically demonstrated the depth of Christ's desire to have men and women, just like you and me, to come under his compassionate care. And let me say that to lay down his life means more than just simply death. We're talking more here than just physical life. It includes personality and could even be translated as soul, S-O-U-L. The sheep are literally the recipients of the shepherd's life, his attention, his care, his time, his labor, his all. Now, I don't know about you, but every year around this time, in the season of Lent and getting ready for Easter and so forth, and Good Friday and Palm Sunday, I think about what Jesus went through on the cross. And I think, why? Why did Christ have to suffer and die for a bunch of sheep? I mean, why? Christ continues to care for us. And yet, put yourself in some sheep shoes for a moment. Sheep are practically defenseless without their shepherd. Now, there were predators out there, both the two-footed kind and the four-footed kind. There were rustlers who would steal and kill the sheep. They are the ones that Jesus spoke of in our scripture lesson for today in John chapter 10, verse 8, when he said, all who come before me are thieves and bandits. Now, there were imposters, there were opportunists, there were people preaching false values and ideas and standards. And to defend against them, you know, there were no burglar alarms or taekwondo classes for the sheep. Their only protector was their shepherd. And not only are the sheep defenseless, but I'll tell you, sheep can't take care of themselves. You talk about high maintenance. Sheep require more attention than any other class of livestock. But Jesus said in verses 9 and 10, he said, whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. You see, Christ is talking about more than just physical life. He's talking about a certain quality of life, an abundant, overflowing surplus of life that we all desire. Abundance in every area of life. Think about it. Physical, mental, emotional, moral, spiritual. With Christ as our shepherd, we can experience the best that life can offer. There's one more thing that we should note here. And that is that the good shepherd gathers his sheep together. In verse 16, it says, I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock and one shepherd. My friends, in today's culture, I'm afraid that we have nearly come to the conclusion that anyone can get into God's kingdom as long as they are good and nice and do some random acts of kindness. We look at ourselves and our possessions and our positions. We look at our education and our religious life and our morality, and we figure, well, I'm not so bad. At least I'm not as bad as that person over there. But my family, let's not be mistaken about this fact. If we or anybody else in the entire world aren't following the Good Shepherd Jesus Christ, we are lost. That's tough news to hear. It's tough news to say, because I like everybody. But the truth is, we all know somebody. Somebody who thinks that if I'm good, that I'll be okay. And actually, that's not true. But Jesus cares enough to seek out and save and restore those who are lost. I think of it this way. As a parent, how much energy would you expend if you lost a child, a son or a daughter? If your son or daughter became lost, would you just sit on the couch? You'd use every ounce of your strength. And God is doing the very same thing for you and me right now. God is using every ounce of strength to love and to long for those who refuse Him. So how do we come to be the sheep? Well, we do that by listening to God's voice. And that means when we recognize that it is God Himself who calls us, it isn't our mom or our dad or our loving grandparent. It isn't Aunt Hazel or Uncle Henry. And it's not that girlfriend or that boyfriend who thinks that they can fix us. Friends, it is God. It is the supreme sovereign God who calls us to Himself. And to be one of God's sheep means that we trust God to lead us, protect us, giving the Lord the right to carefully and compassionately guide our lives with every breath we breathe and every step we take. The truth is, God is calling every one of us. And this call calls for our hearing, which will also result in our doing. You see, God's sheep hear the voice and then they follow. The question for us today is, are we ready to follow, or are we content to wander around aimlessly with no guidance and no direction? My friends, it may be none of my business, but if you are doing that, if you're wandering around aimlessly with no guidance or direction, how is that really working out for you? You see, Every one of us has some aspect of our life that we need to turn over to God, and it's time. It's time to say, here I am, Lord. Pray with me. Loving God, we thank you for your grace and mercy, and that you would receive every aspect of our lives. Bless us now, O God. Give us the direction we need, and may we be victorious with you through Christ our Savior. Amen.